good. So if you wouldn't mind just holding it close there.
You got it.
Is this too intimate? Is this okay?
No, all good.
So we were just chatting upstairs and downstairs about appreciation and humility and trying to make sense of the, you know, the chaos and the...
Of life.
The damage that sometimes this industry can do. You've obviously walked in the fire with so many amazing groups.
Thank you.
Over the years. I want to try and cover it as much as possible. But first of all, as a kid growing up, what was your... ignition moment where you heard or saw something and you went, that's where I want to go in my life?
Well, I think ultimately, I mean, just, you know, being a music lover, I came from a family that had no musicians in it whatsoever, but my parents listened to a lot of music. So I was always, you know, they had vinyl and, you know, and the radio was always on. And
where did you grow up?
I grew up in the South Bay. I grew up in Torrance, California, Gardena right there. Was born in Torrance and I grew up in Gardena, in California, Southern California. It's weird because I always had this love for music. I was instantaneously always, anytime it was on, it was like I had this thing where I could really remember stuff easily too. That's what was kind of funny, you know. It was like,
so you had emotional connections.
It's because I felt that thing that you probably do as well, where you're moved. Something moves you, whether it's a sad song, a happy song, a shitty song. Know what I mean? It's like you're moved and
was it lyrics or was it melody or was it just the whole package?
It's kind of everything, but I think I would have to say it's kind of equally, you know, the all of it. But with that said, rhythm was important, you know. I mean,
so you always felt
drums,
that.
Drums were just, you know, it was just, I guess it was in me. You know, I felt it. And it's funny how it all began, because it was a friend of mine had a drum set. I've told the story a million times. Who lived down the street, and his mom and dad bought him a drum set, and I went over one day, and he was showing it to me. And I remember it was a red Sparkle Kip. I went in the garage. I was like, oh man. I was like, oh, that's, yeah, I just checked it out. And I was like, can I play him? And he's like, yeah, go play. So I sat behind him and I just kind of started messing around. And I remember his mom walked in and she goes, do you play the drums? And I was like,
because no. You already had it.
I suppose that's what I, yeah, you know, I just had that thing. And then my parents always remembered, they said, you know, that typical story. Oh, you were always banging on stuff and tapping on stuff.
Pots and pans.
Yeah.
On the desk at school.
But yeah, always. And so.
Basically it, causing a nuisance. And everyone's like, is he ever going to shut up?
Yeah.
If you can't beat him, you encourage him, kind of thing.
Yeah. always, you know. But that's kind of how it all began, and that's what I remember. That's what I can look back upon and go like, oh yeah, it was always something about the drums and something about music and just wanted to do it. You know, that has stuck with me to this day.
Who's the first band you saw live?
The first, well, I mean, there was a. I think the first big gig I went to. I'm trying to think, like, I can tell you the first punk rock gig I went to was X, the Blasters, and the Gears at the Whiskey. And
X,
that was in
fuck.
Yeah.
Los and that Angeles. Was in,
yeah.
Fucking A.
That
man.
Was late 79, early 80, so right around there. But that's when I knew. Like, that's when it was just immediately set. That's what I want to do.
Mm-hmm. And know? It was punk rock. That was the genre that.
Yeah, and I remember I was with a girlfriend's older sister at the time who took me, and she was like, you like punk rock, you listen to it, I know you like it, you want to go with me to Hollywood. And I remember I snuck out at my parents' house that night, went up there with them, and mind was blown, and that's how it happened.
And you signed that pact right there.
Yeah.
I'm in. So who's your first group that started actually doing stuff like playing shows?
Well, the first band that I played with, you know, was Wasted Youth, LA's Wasted Youth. And that was kind of a few years after I started playing. Friends of mine had been, you know, we've been going to see a bunch of shows and bands, a bunch of punk rock friends. And I got to know these other kids, and it kind of led to that, and I started playing. I came in after Alan, the original drummer, and that was probably late 84, I think, 85, early 85.
How old are you then?
Well, I went on tour with them, their first U.S. tour, and I was underage, so I had to sit outside a lot of the 21
really?
And over clubs. Yeah,
and your parents let you go on tour.
Yeah,
that's
because
amazing.
Yeah, it was. They kind of knew that what I was kind of going after at that point. I think I must have been about 18 at that point. That must have been about 18.
Did you have your head screwed on in the sense that you wanted to try and make a path, not necessarily a career, but a...
No, and that's no, what I tell right. everybody. It's like, it's weird because I knew I was actually, as crazy as it sounds, because everybody always says to do that, but I was really living in that moment.
Just this is it, and then whatever's next is...
You know what I mean? I told my parents were great. They were totally supportive, and I just, you know, went on the road for, I think it was a month and a half, whatever. It was long for a first tour, you know, and it was in a van, and you know, we got robbed, we did this, that, you know, broken down, and this and that, but we finished it, and we did it, and it was awesome. But, you know, I
did this day. Passage, right?
It was it, yeah. And that's when I knew, coming home, it was like, this is what I wanted to
do. There's no going back now.
Yeah, and there really wasn't. There really wasn't, because...
What's that documentary, this Social Distortion... And maybe
another
wasted
state
youth.
Of mind.
Yeah,
another state of mind.
And that's it, right? That documents that. I think is
absolutely
just, your van will break down. You'll get in fights. You'll you know you'll encounter.
You'll make
hurdles.
Friends. You'll lose friends and this and that. But you know.
But if you finish it,
and then you come home and you have some kind of a clear mind of just what you know, because a lot of times, and I've heard you know from and I understand this because it doesn't necessarily have to be just about music or something. But you know when you do something and a lot of times you're going like, oh wow, it's a total blur. I don't really remember much. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
it's
yeah,
like,
yeah, yeah.
It doesn't matter what it is, movie, this, that, whatever. But I know with that, I literally can almost remember every single second of that.
Meal by meal, yeah. Moment by moment.
Tons of that. Yeah. You know what I mean? It's like sleeping on the floor.
Because you're aware of the importance of it as it's unfolding.
And it was happening for the first time, you know, to me. And I wanted to live it to the fullest, I suppose. That's how I was feeling, you know what I mean? It's like, I was young, I was like, so
how
I was,
old were you when you were doing it?
I was 18, I think.
Right.
Yeah, I was 18. I was the youngest one at that point. So.
Were the rest of the guys in the band drinking and partying? Were you
exposed
to?
I was too, everybody was, you know, we all were. It was, you know, it wasn't something outrageous, but we were having fun. You know what I mean? We're doing the typical teenage band on the road, you know.
What are you gonna do, huh?
exactly, so, but I mean, you know, that's, I remember, you know, I was writing in a diary at the time too, which I just recently found at my parents' house because they moved and I went through a bunch of stuff.
Oh, wow, you had it.
Yeah, and I still have it. I mean, you know, it was great. That's when I met, that's where I met all my buddies in the New York scene, because we were in New York for a few shows. Did CBGB's matinee show, which was awesome. I played CB's.
That's why you know Jesse, obviously, because of that.
That's where I know John Joseph and Todd Youth and everybody and all that.
Jesse Mallon.
Yeah, I know. I didn't know Jesse then. I met Jesse later, but I knew all those kids at that point. Jimmy Gestapo, all of them, all my Chicago connection, like Joe Kelly and Herb and everybody. It's like all these people I met, you know, along the way.
Isn't that the beautiful thing, just to like take a quick sidetrack as well, the beautiful thing about touring is you get to tour the world and travel and make like fixes and local connections and genuine friendships in different pockets, like me with today, what I was saying with my friend, like you can just be somewhere that's so far away from home and yet have like a moment that's
absolutely
that's home for them.
Exactly. And the thing is you know, back then there was no cell phones, there was no anything, no, you know, nothing. It was pay phones and stuff. But
and addresses,
we used to write letters to each other, you know, afterwards, just to keep in touch. Hey, how's it going? You know, the scent. And
you build genuine friendships that way, I think, as well, because it's not as flippant and non-committal as social media can
be. Right. And it's like over the years, I mean, through all the different changes and bands and times and, you know, deaths, sadly, and stuff like that, you still remain somehow connected to these people because of those first early days, you know. And for me, it was like, it really, you know, I tell this to a lot of people too. You know, growing up in the South Bay in Southern California, you know, coming up on punk rock and going to shows and meeting kids and all over California and all this stuff in the late, you know, early to late 80s and stuff like that. It really, it schooled you. You know, it schooled me in a lot of ways. It opened me up to a lot of different things, whether it be authors and, you know, bands and places and things, you know, and it was like
politics, ideologies,
all of it. Because at an early age, I just knew that, you know, I didn't want to just stay. And there's nothing wrong with somebody taking that path either. But I knew for me, it wasn't going to stay there. I had to go. I had to go see now for myself. These things I heard and saw and said, now I wanted to go, you know.
And punk rock's that lifeline, right? It's opportunity for
music,
freedom.
Music, punk rock, all of it, you know. I think music in general, if you're if you got it in your, if it's in the mind that that's what you love and want to do, it's obtainable. You know what I mean? You can do this. And that's kind of how it was for me. These doors, everything opened, and I was just kind of like, oh man, it doesn't just stop here. You know, you don't, you know, start, you know, school and then it ends and then you get married and this, that, you know, for some people that's great and this, that, but it just, it keeps going, you keep growing, you keep learning, you know, and you know, that's how I try to live my life to this day.
Well, having just met you, and we do very different things for a job, but there's a similarity in the sense that we're not a fixed full-time employee of any one thing. And yes. So when you get to the end of one experience, there's a certain mindset, I think, where some people would just go, that was amazing, and then they just settle there.
100%.
Whereas I think with people like me and you, without assuming too much, is nope. What you're saying is, yeah, you do one amazing thing, but all that does in you is sets alight this drive, this hustle, where at the end of that one thing, you go, well, then how do we make the next thing happen?
That's right.
And then it just keeps on rolling, keeps on rolling. 100%. You never worry about tomorrow or yesterday. It's just in that moment today.
And
let's
that's
keep
the
this
thing,
going.
You know, and I think that if like yourself, you know, I had to learn how, because it can get a little bit cloudy at times. You
of
know?
Course,
because
yeah.
You get comfortable and you think these people are my life in the sense, and some are, some aren't, as we know, and as you find out rather. And so I think with age, when things keep growing, like you say, and if you realize it's time to take that next step and keep going, it becomes easier. It becomes easier to kind of figure out a room when you walk in now, like, oh yeah, I can kind of see where my people are over there, but hey, those people look kind of interesting. I'm going to go over, you know what I mean? It's like
confidence without
yes.
being a jackass.
Yes. And that's not, it. And not being, you know, held back by fear, because yep. that's what it is. Moving forward to a lot of people and stepping into the unknown is uh-huh. very scary. You know,
I don't feel like it is anymore, though. And you're probably,
I agree.
Right.
I'm the same.
You know,
I for a moment had like this, oh, what now? What? But it's like, wait a minute, hold on a second.
I've been
keep
here
going.
Before. I know what to do.
Yeah, yeah.
Make it up. Fake it till you make it.
That's right.
Right. So,
been in my whole life.
With the New York connections, is that where the Danzig invitation comes from?
No, actually, the Danzig situation came about. It's a real crazy long story I could go into maybe another time. But
yeah, dude, I mean, I've got time.
Well,
it's
I mean, only
you.
In the sense that I remember while... when I was in Wasted Youth, a friend of ours, this kid, Jay Clark, he was a photographer and he toured with Danzig. And he's a good friend of mine who I still recently got reconnected to, thanks to social media.
See, it has its good points,
you know,
right?
Yeah, sometimes, absolutely. But anyways, you know, I was always, as a kid, I was a huge Misfits fan. Huge, you know what I mean? Oh, sorry. Huge Misfits fan as a kid. You know, saw him a few times, Santa Monica Civic, stuff like that, early on. And so I was always a massive fan, you know. But as the years went, you know, and same with Sam Hain. Saw Sam Hain, the Stardust Ballroom, when they did, I think it was 85 or something, and they did a Thanksgiving run show there. But I was always a huge fan because I just...
How could you not be?
You know,
right.
it's funny
it's
because
different.
Back then, a lot of people weren't. That's what's
really?
Strange, yeah.
They rubbed you know? People up the wrong way, did they?
Not, I mean, it was just kind of like, I don't
Dude, come
think...
on, we're doing a podcast. I'll call you later.
Sorry, bud.
Come on, get out. We're doing a fucking podcast. Get out of it.
I love these shirts, by right. the way, guys.
All right, we're good. Sorry, Joe.
Don't worry. Anyway, so when the Danzig thing came about, I was in a band called Sugartooth at that time. We were signed to Geffen, and you know, kind of it was kind of the early days of the grunge stuff.
How important
you know?
And radical was David? Did you have many encounters with him as a dude who like kind of just, you know, Weezer, Guns N' Roses? Like, there's a lot of great groups that
David,
were on that
who?
Geffen.
Oh, I think we only met him like once or twice.
Right.
Once or twice.
So he wasn't as integral to the overall.
I mean, for that world, he was. I think right. for that a little more the rock, bigger rock
yeah.
type thing. Yeah, we were a little bit
the commercially kind of. Yeah.
Oh yeah.
They're gonna make us some money.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I mean, but you know, we did a great record and did a lot of tours, that band and this and that. But, to, you know, it came to an, a kind of a weird halt, I guess. And I was kind of, somebody had threw my name into the audition process for Danzig, who, by the way, Chuck Biscuits is my ultimate favorite drummer ever.
So this is a hilarious detail about your life, because I was just reading up earlier Wikipedia, Joe Castillo.
A lot of it's completely, I don't know who wrote that thing.
Well, the only thing it says about your personal life, they break it up into categories, and it says Joey, personal life, he owns a drum kit.
The one and only,
and it's very valuable, and that was the detail. I was like, I love that they put that.
I do love that
personal life section.
Yeah, because all the rest of it is just almost shit. Sorry,
you can say whatever you want. Okay. It's all good.
Okay, but anyways, all correction though. I own two of Chuck's previous kits.
There you go.
And they are very
valuable,
very,
and rad.
Yeah.
So he's the dude that put you forward for the Danzig slot.
No. Somebody, I can't even remember who it was, a friend of mine, because this is what happened. I came home from tour with my band Sugar Tooth, and I went out to see a friend of mine's band at Raji's in Hollywood, and he told me that he was trying out for Danzig, and I was like, dude, I was stoked for him. I was like, awesome. You know, I wasn't looking to do anything. I was in a band. I had a band that was on it.
And they're doing stuff, and it's happening, and you're settled and looked after.
Yeah, we had a deal, and we were touring and doing our thing. So in the morning, a day or so later, I come home, and this is back before, you know, cell phones and stuff. Check my phone
machine.
Yeah,
that's
machine.
It, right?
Yeah. And there's a message on
Joey,
there.
Joey, we've been calling all week.
Well, it was pretty close. It said, hey, Joey, here's your time to come in for the audition. And I was like, and a phone number, and call this blah, 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 this person. I was like, what is this? Who is, I was like, I don't know what this is even about, you know. So
someone's pranking me.
That could have been.
Yeah,
it could have been. I for all I knew, it could have been my buddy who I saw and told me he was. You know what I mean? So, I just, like I said, I kind of tried to call a few people who I thought may have done it, and they didn't. And then I found out who it was, and I think it was an ex-girlfriend or something. So I called the number, and I was like, I didn't call anyone about this, but, you know, I'm not really looking to. And the funny thing was at that time, Glenn's managers were also trying to manage my band, just on a completely separate, you know, whole different.
Life's crazy like that. Yeah. Sometimes.
So I get on the phone with them. I was like, I'm not really trying to leave my band and go to an audition or anything for anything, but thank you, I appreciate it. And he was like, well, hold on a second. This is where they kind of did me.
The management card.
They told me, well, I'm going to tell you this right now, you know, and I only knew this probably had some truth to it because I knew they were trying to manage us.
We got Todd.
The band's going to get dropped in about, you know, the next couple of months. They're not going to give you money for the next record, so you might as well start thinking ahead. And speaking of which. Yeah. So in my brain, I'm going like, what an asshole.
Yeah.
Now I know this.
Yeah.
I'm going to have to go tell my band.
You
know, it's just like, so he goes, I said, well, okay, I just, let me think about this. They're like, no time to think. What do you want to do? Your time's at Sunday at this time. And this is now on a Friday. I only remember that because all weekend they were supposed to be sending music of the new record, which was four, and a set list of stuff to learn and this and that. And, of course, it never showed up. So, I hung up the phone and I kind of thought about it. And I called a friend of mine. I was like, what do you think? And he was just like, you might as well just go check it out, you know. And so I was like, all right, well, I don't know any dancing stuff, really. I got to, you know, start. So I started calling up a few friends who had CDs and stuff and records and
putting it together. Yeah, because, again, people don't think about it like this, well, but you can just go on Spotify and
Or
YouTube.
Nothing,
do you know what
nothing
I mean?
Like
it's
that.
Like, right, if I need to learn this shit, I need to get those records.
That's exactly what I had to do. So I jumped in the car and raced around a couple friends' houses, picked up some stuff because the package never came that they were supposed to be sending me with all the stuff. So I just kind of planned ahead, and of course it never showed up. So my call time was like on a Sunday, like I almost want to say it was between 11 and 12 midnight. I was the last guy,
right?
Because they were already on callbacks.
Oh, so the gig's very much not a guarantee at all.
100%.
Like, you're just in the mix of people.
I mean, most of the gigs I went after have been like auditions and stuff. I think one or two have been like, you want this gig, you know. But
you've had to fight for most of them.
Yeah, I mean, you know, just go in and play, you know. And I think that, I think I like that. I like to do, I work, I know myself, I work a lot better under those kind of situations, you know, where a little pressure's put on you and it's like,
absolutely,
time to go, you know what I mean?
Oh, and also no time to worry, because the stress and the pressure distracts you from the doubt.
That's right.
You're like, let's just get in there and
yeah,
get it done.
Yeah, because, like, you know, that mental tease can beat you down real quick if you just, if you let it, like with anything, you know. So anyway, so I went in and I was kind of checking out all the people coming and going. I was parked across the street from the place, you know, just kind of making sure, because I knew my buddy was going to be there and all this other stuff. So I went in and I remember John and Erie at the time were completely wiped out. They had been auditioning guys all weekend, and like I said, they were on callbacks. And here I am, the last guy coming in, you know, and they're just like, hey.
At this point, they're like,
ah, yeah, you know, it's
another guy.
Yeah. Playing the same three or four songs, whatever it is they're doing. Yeah, because, you know, ultimately, you usually know between a song or two whether this is happening or not. And,
well, you must know that almost more than anyone.
Well, like, I can say this. I didn't think I got the gig.
Really?
But no, I didn't. I didn't. And I told them, you know, and I went, I said, listen, you know, I just got the material. I just got the call. I was the only, I think at that point, I was the only one who wasn't on a callback.
And this is your first big audition as well.
Yeah,
so you're not
used
to walking into that room and owning it.
That's it. You know, I was over at Mates in North Hollywood, and I went in and, like I said, did it. And I think we played like three or four songs. And, you know, I was just kind of like, you know, I didn't think I did very well. I got through the stuff, and but I, you know, it was more about arrangements and stuff at that time. Cause, you know, they asked me to learn a couple new songs, which I couldn't do because I didn't know. So I just kind of walked through them when they played them for me. You know, it goes like this, and try to do something. You know, it was like, yeah, you know,
just make it up, yeah.
So I was like, yeah, like that's really gonna work, you know. But you know, you can kind of figure out a little bit what's happening. But you know, but it was great though. When I got there, like I said. You know,
what was Glenn like in the
audition?
He
was great.
Yeah.
He was like, you know, he walked in, he was, what's up, man? How are you? This and that. He's like, yeah, I mean, I remember, you know, I know your band Wasted Youth, and I heard this, and a cool, and, you know, again, it was like that punk rock connection thing, you know, which was, which ultimately Glenn has always said was a big part of why I got the gig.
Right.
You know, he really, he knew I understood that. And of course, that's where Biscuits and him and Ariel all came from. So there was that thing that kind of comes with that kind of a player. So roots wise.
Yeah.
So,
and like a mental approach.
Yeah.
Like sincerity.
You know, exactly.
Authenticity.
Absolutely.
You ain't going to be a diva or a fucking.
I mean, you know, it's like it's you walk in and you do it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's the kit that's there, you're going to use it. You know, what's happening is happening at that moment, you deal with it, you know, whether it's good or bad. So he came in, he was great, and I was just stoked to meet him finally, like, oh, you're right.
Yeah.
You know? Played the songs, and, you know, they were, the manager was in there, and I think the last song I did was Mother or something like that, and we walked out and said, okay, cool, thanks. And they said, good, thanks for coming in, dude. We'll talk to you later. I walked out fucking on cloud nine, dude. I was stoked just because I got to play with Danzig.
At least I just got to jam with the dude.
You know, yeah. It was like, you know, it was John, Erie, and Glenn. And it was, you know, I was obviously coming in after my hero, which was hard. But, you know, it's Biscuits. And I was just like, this is the best. You know what I mean?
How old are you at this point?
I want to say 25.
Right. So still a kid, really.
Yeah.
Young.
25. I think it was right around there, 25. So that was it. I went home. I jumped in the car with my girlfriend at the time, and she was like, it sounded great. I was outside. And I was like, oh, cool. You know, whatever. I was like, I don't think I got it, but I had a great time. And it was awesome. And I honestly, I did not think about it a second longer. It was weird. It was bizarre. We went home. We stopped to get some food before we went home. Went to bed.
I almost think if you put too much expectation and hope on something, you know, A, if you don't get it, it's the most crushing feeling in the world.
Well, I think you just, as you learn, okay, there's a weird thing that happens. Like you said, this was my first real big audition with somebody, with this, you know,
fucking an
international world touring band at the height. So I wasn't, you know, I had been touring already a few years now with, you know, Wasted Youth, and then now my other band, Sugar Tooth. So I know what it's about, and I know I just recorded a record, and we've been, so there isn't this really, really thing that where I'm going, there's so much at stake.
Yeah, you know what I mean.
But there's also this thing that's just like, all right, well, if it happens, it's cool. If it doesn't, I'm in my band. And so I didn't really like go there.
You weren't chasing it.
No.
There's no like desperation or need.
Yeah, and as much as I wanted it,
mm-hmm.
and I would just love to have this. Yeah, 100%. I just was like, you know, I was still cool with, I gave it my best shot. Good, I'm done. I'm glad I did it. And that's what I said. I was like, I'm really just glad I did it. Because I wasn't about to do it. I was about to not go, you know? And my girl at the time was just like, come on, you got to go. You got to just do this, you know, whether you get it or not. So the next morning, I remember I got up and I think my girl had left. She had left in the morning and she went to do whatever her thing was at the time. And I'm at my house or my apartment, and the phone rings and I'm hello, and it's their manager. It's like, hey, John, hey, Joe, it's John, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, I got Glenn on the line. And I'm like, oh, hey. And they're like, so great job yesterday. Thank you for coming down. Glenn talking to me, you know. You got the gig. And I was like, I'm lying there like kind of, I was awake, but I'm just lying there in my bed going like, holy shit. I'm just kind of like, really? I go, nah. You know, I said that too. I'm like, really? I'm like, yeah. I'm like, yeah, of course. And Glenn's super, he's great. He's super excited and just like, yeah, man, you got the gig. And John's like, okay, dude, I need you to send me your lawyer. I need you to send me blah, blah, blah. Your lawyer, if you have one, we can get this deal done and blah, 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 and this and that. And photo shoot tomorrow and then rehearsal the next day and then show the following day.
Straight in. 1, 2, 3, fucking.
And it's funny because I found out why and how. That's when I first got my taste of what the
industry.
Managers of people are. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, he shoved it on me and did not give me a second to think about it or breathe or hesitate or talk or nothing. And I was like, oh, well, I go, you know, and I was like, well, I still got to call my band. And the guy goes, no, dude, clock's ticking. Got to know right now. You want the gig or not?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I was just like,
it's like magicians, isn't it? Sleight of hand.
100%. Mind you, over the phone. So
yep.
I'm going like, you know.
Yeah, okay, sign me up. I'm in.
That's
yep.
it?
Yeah.
I'm like, okay, I'm down. Where'd I got to be? I'm going to be at this place tomorrow and for the photo shoot, rehearsal the next day, show the following day. I'm like, a show? Okay. Call back in, you know, half hour. The assistant's going to give you all the details. I'm like, assistant? I'm like, okay, cool. Hang up. I'm like, fuck. I go, dude, I got the gig. So I jump on the phone. I'm trying to call my chick at the time. I called a couple friends. I'm like, man, I got the gig. I got the Danzig gig. Like, no way. It was like, dude, that's great. They're like, what's the deal? I'm like, oh, I don't know. I'm going in.
I don't know, but I'm in.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Isn't
then
that
I go,
fucking nuts?
Yeah. I go, I got to, you know, I got a rehearsal the next, a photo shoot tomorrow, rehearsal the next day. I think 2 days of rehearsal and then a show. So it was a free show at the Whiskey because they were getting presented with their gold records for live.
Right.
Thrall. They had, you know, and Mother took off this,
mm-hmm.
with the video and all that stuff, the Halloween show. So they were getting presented their gold records and they were releasing. No. They were doing their gold records and they were going to do a free show. And then the record was going to come out, I think, a week later with the Tower Records in store. So, or something like that, or there was an in-store after that show, I can't remember, something like that. So I'm like, holy shit. So I was like, what? Well, I told my couple of my buddies, and then I called my lawyer because I wanted
you
to
did have one then.
The band had one.
Right.
And I wanted to call and I wanted to ask him if that was true, what they were telling me about the band not getting picked up and about the record and stuff getting dropped.
So you make sure you're just not.
I just wanted to make
deep.
Sure because I didn't want to be not saying something to the guys when I had to tell them that I was going to do this, you know. Because in my brain, I wasn't leaving my band. I was just going to go on tour with Danzig and come back to my band, you know. Just thinking that that's what was going to be. It was just going to be a tour thing, a cycle. So I called my lawyer at the time, the band lawyer, and I said, "What do you think I should do?" And he said, "Well, I think you should take the gig." He goes, "I don't think you should pass something like this up." The band's not going to be making a record right away. He goes, "You're not. I don't think they're going to drop the band, but I know that you're not going in to make this record as soon as you guys had thought.
How and fucked up is that, that that's a lawyer that well, knows that's all the that thing. Much about, right? You're
he
like,
was
huh?
like, I have to tell you, you know, and I was just
you're
saying.
You're a lawyer. He's meant to like, do the accounts.
Yeah. And I'm like, fuck, man, you know, really? So I made the call to my dudes, and I called them up. I called the managers up at that time. I said, hey, you know, we got to have a meeting. You know, I kind of broke it down to the managers, like, you know, and of course they, you know, they rammed it down the dude's throats right over, like over the phone, instead of letting me tell them. And then my phone starts blowing up before we even have the meeting. And, you know, it just kind of got a little messy, but we still sat down. And
Did you remain friends?
We did. And I still am friends with two of them to this day. It was a little broken for a minute, and it wasn't in a sense of anything other than we just needed a little bit of time, you know. And
you were almost thrust into that singer scenario where they take the front man out of the group.
Yeah,
it was almost like that, right?
Well, here's what happened. So, it like I said, it was, you know, it went down, and I told them, and then I went on the road, and then I was gone. And then within that cycle, which was, I think it was a good 2.5 years probably, I went back and recorded the second record with my old band. They asked me to come back I could do the record and write some stuff with them and go in. We went in and did it with the Dust Brothers and stuff. And it was rad. I had a great time. You know, it was like, it fell right back into place immediately. You know, I did some live shows with them when I could. And then they ended up auditioning a couple people, you know, because I just couldn't do both. And, you know, like I say, we're friends still, you know. I still talk to them all the time. You know, they still talk about wanting to do something again. So,
You strike me as a dude, Joey, who seems to hopefully have good relationships with everyone that you've worked with.
I try to. Like, absolutely, man. It's like, I don't think, you know, that there's really any bad blood between anybody that I've ever played with, you know. There's always that moment of when something goes down where, you know, everybody's going to kind of step away for a minute, let the dust settle and this and that. And, you know, next time around you see him, it's a hug and a, hey, how are you? You know, and
what a wise man once said to me, that nothing ends well.
Huh?
Right. So whether it's a relationship, it's a, you know, a band, whatever it is, if it ends, that's going to be gnarly, and there's going to be pain and
let's be honest, the word
end
is it's final. It's done. Yep. It's over. That doesn't necessarily have to be something to be angry about, but it could be sad, or it could be, you know, there could be that time. I think that we've all been in those places, I think, where you kind of know it's done and you're waiting for the other person to maybe say something or use something. So that kind of starts to feel nasty. And maybe,
yeah, that's,
you know,
when it gets mean. Yeah. Is when people don't have that courage or that honesty to just go, it's done, right?
Yeah.
Let's call time.
Yeah.
And then it's when done. It is done, then you kind of... It's the people that can't accept that something's over, I think, that struggle.
Yeah, it's that anger.
You have to accept it, don't
you? Sure, you know. And I've learned, you know, I can honestly
say...
This
drink's delicious, by the way. It's so good.
It looks amazing.
Like ruby red shit.
It looks like a Jolly Rancher watermelon.
Just in liquid form. Right?
Yeah. But yeah, you know, so... I ended up, and I was, then from that point on, I was with Danzig. I was with Glenn for about, I think, 7 years.
What was it like working with that dude? Because I've met him a couple of times. I'm good friends with Casey Chaos, and he's close
with
Glenn.
Casey too.
I love that man so much.
He's a sweetheart.
Great dude. Well, actually, here's a quick thing. Casey and Nick Oliveri are two dudes, right, that have a very bad reputation around the world because they're crazy, right, and they've done gnarly shit. And there's a lot of people out there who will trash talk both those guys, I think, for either behavior or stuff. But I know Casey well. I don't know Nick well, but I've interviewed him and spent time with him. And for me, they're two of the sweetest, greatest, coolest people ever. They are wild animals, but
absolutely.
That's kind
of... And here's the thing. This is what I've learned along the way.
Because you were in Blood Clot with Nick and obviously Queens, which we'll hope you get
to. Me and
soon.
Nick go way back. Me and Casey go way back. Me and Glenn go way back. And there's a thing.
Glenn is one of those dudes as
absolutely,
well.
Absolutely. I was just about to say. Yep. I get that question all the time. I get more questions about Glenn
really
in my entire life, career and everything, than anything. Mm-hmm. Anyone or anything. And to this day...
Oh, well, them wanting to know dirt and...
Just that. What's he
negativity.
Like? Is he an asshole? Is he cool? Is he this? And to this day, you know, Glenn and I have remained friends. I just saw him recently, you know, at the Misfits show in L.A.
How good
a few
was that?
Times now, and it was incredible.
Yeah.
Incredible. I couldn't be happier for him. You know, it's so well-deserved and hard-earned, I have to say. But he's, you know, he's like my brother. I love him to death, and I know that if he'd do anything for me if I asked and vice versa. And, you know, he was tight with my parents, and I met his parents at the time way back, you know, and his brothers. And, you know, Glenn is, I don't regret anything, and I have nothing but good to say about him. You know, there's ups and downs always with everybody, and that's with everybody. But there's, I don't really think that there's anything that I could ever trash or, you know, talk shit on, you know. And it's the same goes for somebody like Nick, you know. It's like, I, you know, Nick's my brother as well, you know.
He's a special guy.
And that's the thing, is those kind of people, those kind of things, in general, whether, you know, no matter who it is or what it is, it's like, if I don't think they're really doing any harm, you know, directly to anyone maliciously or intentionally. And, you know, thing people can say and do what they want. I've never had this experience with any of those people, you know.
Well, same with Casey as well. Like, the,
yeah,
I mean, Glenn's different, I think, because he's just a bit more like Marmite. You either love him or you hate him. Whereas Casey and Nick are very much, they're wild animals.
Absolutely. And what happens when you try to contain a wild animal,
yeah.
You know? It's like, and, you know, Nick's my brother. He lives down the street from me. His girl is best friends with my wife. It's like, you know, we have a long history, and we play together in Blast, we play together in Blood Clot, we play together in Queens. You know, it's like, it's something that is, I don't know. I've always been put in places with people that other people think are misfits or crazy and this, that, and I don't have problems. I love that.
Do you know what I think it is from what I know of Nick and Casey, is they both just had very tumultuous, dramatic, intense upbringings, which created a certain kind of psyche in them both, where they're loose and they're a little bit unpredictable. But actually,
which is
awesome, the bad stuff that they've done comes from a place of pain, and
100%.
Do you know what I mean? And they're not bad fucking dudes. No. They're just people that have demons.
They're not at all, you know. And I know, like I say, I don't, like, just as you're saying, there's nothing intentional that is done, you know, to hurt anyone or maliciously say or do. It's like, it's just, you know, they're wild animals, you know what I mean? It's like, and they are not the first, and they are not going to be the last.
I hope they're not, you know? But I do feel like people like that are a dying breed.
Well, it's a dying breed
in the Oliverio chaos.
Well, the times have definitely changed.
Because that's not the done thing anymore, is it, to be fucking loose? Like, people, now we're in this culture where it's like, with smartphones and,
well, I think that's
yeah, look at this guy, he's an asshole, fuck that guy. And you're like, what? But he made great music, and he's loose, let Iggy pop.
Listen, like, that's the thing. I agree, but that's the problem with, I don't even know if it's just, it more has to do with, and I don't mean that in any kind of way make anyone feel weird about what, but I feel like when I was a kid, until it came, you know, when you looked at a rock star, for instance, or somebody who was a successful musician in these giant bands or big bands, little bands.
Well, even comedians and actors as well.
Comedians and actors as well. People in the spotlight, so to speak. You know, there was a bit of mystery, because there wasn't this thing where you felt like you knew them, because you were flipping through Instagram or Facebook or television 24/7, where they were, you know, it's like, it wasn't shoved down your throat. You had to go find magazines. You had to go find records. You had to go find other kids who may have heard this or saw this, and maybe, you know, been to a show and this, that. I met him. It's like, there was still mystique.
Dude, let's look at two of the biggest modern day rock stars today. Dave Grohl, Josh Homme. They're probably two of the biggest, right? Are they on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook? None of that.
Right?
And that's a telling sign, I think.
But the thing is, though,
people still have that mystery.
Well, but they're on everything else, though. You know what I mean? It's like, it's whether they are themselves on it, their image and their
is
music,
ubiquitous.
It's there, and it's there a lot. You know what I mean? And like I said, there's nothing wrong with that, but that's where the audience they really feel this need, like, you know, they have to know the next move. They want to know where they're going to eat. They want to know where they're going to shop. They want to know where they're going to play. They want to know where the kids go to school. They want to know where they're going to buy their next pair of sneakers. They want to know. It's like it's just too much information.
Well, also beyond that, I think that people nowadays feel a sense of ownership over celebrities. Yeah, because they're like, I know this person because I know their every move, thought, dietary intake.
Yeah.
So then they call them up on it. Anyway, we could go down that road all day.
Yeah.
How does the Queen's call come about? What happens there?
Funny enough, a friend of Casey Chaos,
right,
Nigel Kopp, who was a photographer with the Queens and a good friend of all of ours.
Because he's on that record, isn't he?
Yeah.
And fucking, what's the dude from the Dwarves? I love that guy, Black. It's Kip Casper or Songs for the Deaf. Yeah. Like, dude, that album, I think, is one of the last great, game-changing, dangerous, modern-day rock, like,
yeah,
huge fucking album.
Absolutely.
And that lineup as well, Lanigan, Grohl.
Great. Like,
that lineup at that time, forget about it, right?
And that's right when I came in, right at that point. Everybody was still there. You know, Lanigan was there, Nick was still there, myself, Troy, and Josh, you know, and it was like that for, sadly, just that cycle, you know, because Nick, obviously, the end came for Nick at the end of that, but... But back to how that happened was, I was, my band, that band Sugar Tooth, prior to Danzig and everybody, we had played a few times around with Kais and stuff, so I knew Josh a bit here and there, and we had been, we kind of became a bit reconnected when I went out playing with Goatsnake, opening for the Queens in the UK while they were on R, they were still touring R just before Def. I always went out with Goatsnake opening. And so I hung out, you know, got to see him again and hang out a bit. And
are you a drinker, Joey?
No, I had already gotten sober at that point.
Right. How long have you been sober now?
I want to say 22 years.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
Congratulations.
Cheers, man.
That's a fucking healthy long stint. Good on you, dude.
Yeah, so I got sober at the end of Danzig, the last 2 years, I think, of Danzig. So, yeah. Then going into Queens, I was already sober. So I was out, and funny enough, I went to see
Amen. Yeah,
at the Viper Room.
Right.
I came off tour, and I don't know if I had spoken to Casey or maybe Paul Figg or somebody, and they, you know, heard they were playing at the Viper, and I was like, oh, cool! I just got back into town. I'm gonna go check it out. So I went there.
You did that band at that time as well.
Fucking great. Loved them. I was at, and you
like
know, Casey,
a fucking a firework in a submarine.
Loved it. And early on, the early stages of that, Casey asked me to play drums for that.
Really?
Yeah, but I was busy in dancing and doing stuff. But anyways, I had was going to the show, and I believe they had already played. And you know, it was one of those shows where it was packed, and by the end of it, I think Casey had fucking berated the audience for half of them. They were all gone.
Yeah. That sounds like Casey.
It was awesome. Of course I'm going, I love this. Yeah. It's great. So I was hanging out afterwards, and I saw my friend Nigel. And I was just kind of talking to him a bit. And I knew at the time that he was roommates with Josh. And he said to me, he goes, hey, did Josh ever get a hold of you or anybody? And I was like, about what? And he goes, they were looking for a drummer. And I was like, I thought they had already found a drummer. I go, I heard last that they had already found somebody. He gets like, no, there's a few people that have been playing, you know, playing with them that they're going back and forth through, who are telling people that they're the drummer and stuff, but they haven't really found anybody. But he asked, your name came up a few times. And
let's be real as well, right? Because at that point in time, that record is fucking astronomically huge. Oh, album wasn't out.
No, Def wasn't out yet. They had just finished it. David went out and did the promo tour.
Right.
And Dave had agreed to sign on to do the whole tour. When they finished the promo tour, which I think was like 2 weeks or something, he decided not to do it. He was going to go do another Foos record. So, you know, they had, the record was dropping, the tour was booked, everything was loaded and ready to go. So they'd been auditioning drummers and for a good couple of weeks or so. So I was just, you know, a fan, obviously. And I actually was at the show that they did at the Troubadour, mm-hmm, with Dave Drummond and everybody for that. So I said no, and he goes, well, give me your number, I'm gonna give it to Josh. And I was like, ah, oh, dude, at this point in the game, it's, you know, they're like, he's like, no, I'm just gonna give it to him, you know what I mean? Like, yeah, because I had already heard that they had somebody, and I knew the guy who said, who he was telling people that he, to the drummer. I was like, okay. So I just gave my number, so whatever. So a couple of days go by, and I didn't hear nothing. And I, again, didn't even think about it. And I was out doing, running some errands. I think I was actually at my drum company at the time, going through some drums or something. And I got a call. And it was, I can't remember if it was, I think it was Lanigan.
Does he talk like he sings?
A bit, yeah, yeah,
yeah. Tom Waits style, fucking.
Yeah, yeah. I think it was Mark I spoke to, and he was like, you know, asking me what I was up to and if I could come play with the band. And I was like, I thought you guys had a drummer. Like, no, we don't. But blah blah blah. You want to come down and play a little bit? And I was like, yeah, okay. I'll, you know, just let me know what's up. So I hung up. I remember I was driving home that night. From where I was, it was a couple hours later, I was doing something, and Josh called me and he said, hey, you know, would you want to come play? Maybe we're looking for somebody, blah blah blah. Real, just kind of short,
nonchalant.
Yeah, you know, we both were just keeping it really easy and not like, no pressure on either one of us and everything, because I knew that it was right around the corner. Like, literally it was days away that they were trying to do something. So I was like,
that's the other thing as well, if you come across too keen and overzealous, it can turn people off, right?
Absolutely. But I mean, at the same time, I had, you know, again, I'm in a band, I have a gig, it's like, good. I'm not like, oh, I need this.
Yeah.
And I was just a huge fan. I just have always loved the band. So he was like, okay, let's get together on the weekend. Yeah, I think it was like the weekend coming up. And I said, okay. He's I'm going to send you some stuff. I'm going to send you a package of the new record, and then I'll blah, blah, blah.
Like, I know this goes. I better get to Amoeba now.
Same fucking thing happened. Same exact thing happened. So I get, I have all the old stuff, thankfully. Yeah. I can say I was an honest fan, and I had all the stuff. Just didn't have the new record. So just as I'm getting ready to start learning everything, I think they, you know, and it was funny too, because it was a bit of a nightmare, because they sent me deaf on a burn, it was a burn copy of the record, because it wasn't out yet. And
then
all the commercials
shit.
Are on it. Right, so right. It was one big long song. I couldn't. So I was going, oh.
So you got to sit through all those.
Like, I, there, and
it's,
I didn't know the
saga.
Title.
Songs, yeah. You can't even feel it. You're like, fuck's sake.
Yeah, it's like, other than the first song, it was like, for the, you know.
Dude, and that first fucking song.
Yeah, Millionaire.
Fucking A.
So, I'm like, okay, so we agree. They gave me a time. I'm going to come down in the next couple of days. I'm like, cool. So I start working on it, you know, and a day goes by. And then I get a call from Josh again. He's like, dude, I'm so sorry, but we're not going to be able to do this. My grandmother just passed away, and I got to go back to Palm Springs. I said, you know, right then and there, I said, no problem, dude. Handle your biz. You know, thanks anyways. If anything should happen, just let me know. He's like, I'm really bummed, but, you know, I've got to take care of this stuff, and, you know, there's obviously no time. The tour starts on Monday. I said, okay. I just said, you know, let me know how it goes. I'll be at the free show at Amoeba, which is like, that Monday was in San Diego or San Francisco. The next day was San Diego, and then the next day was a LA show, Amoeba free, the three free shows. That fuck coming up week. This is like on a Wednesday or something. I'm like, okay, hang up. And that's what it was. No, I take that back. This is when Lanigan called me, because I remember, right, Nigel had got my number to Josh. So let me jump ahead forward now correctly. Lanigan calls me
after you
Friday,
been,
after it was already, yep, called off. It, yep, was like, yep, now like a Friday, two or three days later. And he's all, hey, man.
You mean,
can you do, yeah, hey, Joey, and old Scratch. He's like, I'm sorry, man, but is there any way you can make this, maybe come play? I'm like, what? I go, what happened? He's like, Josh is just kind of tripping. He just kind of feels like if we don't try this, it's going to be fucking eating him the whole time, that maybe we should have. We don't even know how it could have been or what it was like. Can you maybe get it together this weekend? I said, yeah, okay, just let me know the songs and let me know what's up. that's when the CD came, because that guy never got the first time because they didn't send it because it fell through. Now he sent me the new record, and it was, like I said, this big one long song. So I'm like, shit, now I'm trying to get this. So I said, yes, of course. I said, you know, let me know what day. And they said, okay, you know, Josh going to call you tonight. He's still in Palm Springs, you know, handling his family business. So I was like, of course, no problem. So he got back to me and he said, see you at Sunday at noon. I'm like, cool. Send me the address. I get home and I just start, you know, banging
skipping
through.
Skipping through that one track.
Yeah, I made sure to hit. They told me, you know, obviously no one knows, Millionaire. And I think it was maybe Songs for the Deaf, if I could get to that. But I also had, you know, I also knew a lot of the first record because it was like my favorite record. So Avon was in my pocket already.
Regular John.
That, yeah. All that kind of stuff, you know.
Lost Art.
So, yeah. And I toured with them all in R. So I knew the stuff that they were kind of doing and how they're. So I went in on Sunday, got my shit together. I said, do I need a kit? They're like, no, there's a kit there. Just come in, come by.
Just bring your sticks.
That's what it was. Just bring your stick. So I get there, and the funny thing was Josh didn't tell anybody except for Nick and Lanigan. So Troy had no idea that I was coming, and I knew Troy, and I knew his drummer, who was one of the guys who was, you know, at the time trying out and got the gig. So that's why it was kind of weird, and it was just, you know, it was just that thing where you
just thrown in,
just,
right?
Yeah, again, I was just thrown in, and I walk in the room, and of course, you got Al and Natasha there, who I've been a fan of in 11. For years, and I'm like, oh great, all these fucking people, you know. First, I mean, it was just a band there first, and then they showed up and they're checking it out. So we get in there and just kind of set up what I had to set up, and I clicked it off, and it was go. And we start playing, and we're playing, and it's, you know, it sounds fucking heavy and raw, and it's fucking louder and shit, and we're like about a song or two in, and you know, Josh is like, is there anything you want to play? And I was like,
to you.
I said, yeah. I go, how about Avon? Because I love Avon.
Yeah.
He's like, okay, cool. Start clicking off, start playing it. About halfway through, he stops. He's like, okay, cool, man. He goes, thank you. He goes, hold on a second. All right, just thanks for coming. And I'll be right back. So I'm like, oh, you know, I'm thinking, okay, cool. That was fun. You know, I'm packing up my shit. Sounds good. He comes back and he goes, okay, dude, come on, step outside, and we got to figure this out because I got to make some calls and get rid of, talk to the old people and make some changes. And I'm like, what? And he goes, well, can we talk business later in this night? I'm like, what? And he goes, yeah. He goes, we got to do this. Yeah. I'm like, fuck. He goes, I got to go back home. I got to handle some business. But can we get back here about 3:00? I'm like, okay. He goes, because dude, we
that
gotta,
day.
Yeah, because the show was the next day.
Yeah.
So I'm like, oh shit. I'm like, again. I'm like, okay. Split, go home with my girl. I'm like, I got the queen. She's like, why? Yeah, it's like, so. And it's out. You know, a few people all around LA all of a sudden found out, and it was just like, holy shit. Go in later that day. Literally, I think we started rehearsal from 3 p.m. till 3 p.m. Just pounding a set together because I had never even heard anything really. So I had to learn, you know.
First it giveth.
Yeah. Well, we weren't doing that yet in the set. Right. So, but it was, you know, Song for the Deaf, Millionaire, No One Knows. I think we're still doing God, and we're just doing Go with the Flow. So me and Josh started talking. He goes, look, dude, can you do this? And I said, yeah, of course. The crazy thing was I had just come from the day before a Danzig video shoot. So I was like, shit, now I got to call Glenn.
Right, okay.
So I'm like, you know, this is going to suck, you know.
You know that in your heart.
Yeah, I just knew, you know. But I also knew it was a time where it was time to go, you know.
You felt really, that in yourself.
We weren't doing much, you know, and it was, you know, it just wasn't, we weren't working as much as I needed to be and wanted to be. But I felt bad, you know, because he's my brother and this and that. And I didn't want to, so I called him. And it was a little weird at first, you know. But
or it's that thing, isn't it? Nothing ends well. Again, it's,
yeah,
like,
you know, we
just ran its course. I've got to go over here.
But it wasn't
now.
Before I knew it, everything was completely back to normal. You know, I went to see him, hit him up when I was on tour, in fact, and Josh came with me. Back then, this is way back. We were in Florida together somewhere, funny enough. And they were on tour, and I hit him up. Hey, Glenn, I'm in town. Is it cool if I come in? He's like, yeah, come through. got me and Josh, and I think Brody was with us too. So we went, and it was great. Just like nothing to that, it's been right on track again, you know. So that happened. Was thrown right in. Tour started. So what they did was we did the free shows, the first three free shows, and then we took a couple of days to start working on the full set. So the tour got pushed back 2 or 3 days, and then we picked up those shows at the end of that leg, and that was it.
And you go on tour and play the fucking, as I said, the last great, I think, era-defining, like, cultural, you know, statement that guitar
to me,
music has,
that was
done, I think,
the last real
right
rock and roll record that made a statement and an impression to where it could not be ignored.
Yeah, it you was like, I mean, the Appetite for Destruction of its era.
Yeah, I mean, it's like it was a big record. It was, and I don't, it doesn't even, I don't mean in a sense of numbers. I just mean in a sense of song quality,
zeitgeist capturing.
It was a time. I feel like it was a weird time that was ending for rock.
Well, it was the end of the record business, really, wasn't it?
And this new thing was happening, you know, and we caught that tail end of it. And I mean that record, because
yeah,
we had all been, everybody had been playing through those years, you know, between bands and stuff, and keeping it real and raw, so to speak. But you know, it's like, yeah.
Yeah, you rode that fucking wave.
Yeah, and it was insane.
Was it unbelievable?
Man.
Was it everything you
it
could
It was the absolute, probably, that, you know, I know the lineup was just as great with Grohl, but I mean, that lineup too that we toured with, it was monster.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
well, I don't know whether it was Dean that said it in a podcast or whether it's something I read somewhere else, but he was like, if you imagine all those figures like fucking Lanigan, Troy, because Troy's got that, you know, individual look as well, Josh, Nick, just like, well, you know, you play in bands fucking all the time. You're backstage at a festival and just seeing that crew.
Dude, that's what I was saying. It was, we rolled in like a gang.
Like,
it was never, ever something that was overlooked. And it wasn't intentional. It was just the...
And you weren't peacocking or fucking...
No, not at all. We were the least of that. It was at that point, Queens still had a lot of its...
Underground integrity.
Underground punk rock ideas and ways it went about. We had a, you know, our sound, our gear, you know, how we stepped up on stage, how the show went down. It's like, it was like, I always say, we used to use this term a lot amongst each other. It was like really this controlled chaos that we used to do, because we could push something speed wise we could push things, you know, arrangement wise everything got just pushed to the very fucking edge to where it was just about to fall off the rails, and we could reel it back together. There was something that could happen where it just,
it's Indiana Jones, it's when the thing goes up and lands back on the track at the last minute.
It was all the time
yeah,
and it didn't matter, you know. It, the insanity that was going on at that time,
and is
as
there
well,
fucking just drugs and chaos everywhere as well. Like, obviously, you're the sober guy.
Wouldn't have changed it for the world. I was, and I say this to the, you know, just like I about with Glenn and everything else, and you know, it was, you know, they were my brothers, and we all. It was a time that it's never going to come back. It's never going to be recaptured. It's just like, it was just that time. It was where everybody was, and everybody was there together, and.
The perfect mixture of
combusting
elements.
Yes, down to everything, you know. So, and it was still everybody was still having a great time. It was a lot of fun because it was still dangerous and it was still reckless and it was still controlled and it was still, you know, alive. You know, not that it's not anymore, but it's different now.
Well, Nick said something interesting to me. He said that now there's players that are attached to that brand, and he calls it a brand. He's like, you know, we built this thing which is beyond a band name. It's like a Misfits or
totally
like Queen. And he was like, nowadays there's players attached to that he said he wouldn't have wanted,
like, you know. And that's the thing, him and I have talked about, you know, and
because it was their thing, right? It was him and Josh that built that from nothing to what that level was then. That was their combined joint vision.
Nick was the face. You know, Nick was the face early on and stuff. And, you know, and it's not to take away anybody's creativity with anything either, because we all know, and it's regardless of, you know,
skill set,
how things came to an end with Josh and I. You know, we're friends and we're cool, but it, you know, it came to an end, and it wasn't exactly the best way to come to an end. But I've never once ever said that the guy's talent is just beyond. You know, he's one of the best that I've ever worked with. You know, and I'm always proud for everything that I was doing and a part of, just like I was with Glenn. And you know, there's a thing that there's a real feeling of accomplishment and making a mark and making an impression,
which is beyond success. It's about legacy, right?
And and that's just it. I've never, to this day, I've never been a person who was out to capture success. I love what I do on all levels, whether it's playing into a room of 10 or a festival of 20,000, 30,000, bigger. You know, it's like, it's the same thing for me. It is the absolute same thing. I approach them both the exact same way, you know, and that's to have as much fun as I can possibly have, to kick as much ass as I possibly can. And we all know that things happen to where it's out of our hands. Some stuff is just better than others, and some days are better than others. But I don't ever go like, oh, well, there's not enough people here, or this, I don't like where we're on the bill, or...
Or my dinner is shit.
Yeah. Or my room is shit. Or, it's like...
Diva shit.
Give a fuck, you know? It's about the music. Because, like, you know, it's as everybody knows, and everybody's heard it a million times, the arts in general, music, it's bigger than all of us.
And not just about the music, but the people and the experience that it affords you, whether you're a punter or a player. It's cheesy, but there is something about... I'm not a religious person, but there's something about that element of, like, when you're at a show... It's a communal moment that exists in that time, and then it's gone. But for that one moment, 100%. You're all there, and you're like, bliss. That's why it's tough.
It's tough to get things back together.
Mm-hmm.
Especially, you know, over years, because people grow, not necessarily just grow apart, but they grow, you know, they either grow or they don't as players and things. And you know what I mean? It's like, it's not good or bad. It's just that you're not, everybody is
nothing
no longer on
same.
That same path, on that, taking that in that same lane. You know, they've, everybody's veered.
Yep.
And it's hard to wrangle. It's hard to wrangle, you know, it's like
hurting. And that's true of relationships and friendships and everything. It's not just bad.
We all know what that's like, trying to get back with an ex-girlfriend. You know, it's just like,
yeah,
this is never going to work.
Recapture that old magic that once was. Like,
but I mean, you know, and again, it's... It was a magical time, as cheesy as that sounds. And again, something I would never have changed for the world, you know.
I mean, dude, usually I do an hour. We're at an hour now. I could talk to you forever. You don't really tour the UK with the Bronx, do you? That's the great shame
for
me.
Well, I was over there the last time.
Are you going to be coming over anytime soon? So here's the thing. I've never seen you play with them before. And last night.
You didn't see it last night?
No, last night was my first time.
Oh, cool.
Ever. Like, I love Dave, and Dave's an incredible
love
drummer,
my buddy Dave.
And we've toured loads, and I've spent loads of time with him.
He's
but
my brother.
I've always wanted to see you do your thing, and last night was my first time, and I was just in awe of the, like, the Bronx thing is about speed, power, like, aggression, but groove, and you're a fucking perfect fit
in that
dynamic.
Thank you.
If you ever do get to the UK with them,
I will be there.
Do a part two.
Absolutely.
There's so much other stuff that I want to talk to you about.
100%, man. My pleasure, and thank you for having me. And of course, the Bronx are my brothers, and it's where I am now, and it's what I love, and I'm having a fucking great time.
Are you on the new record with them?
I am.
Fucking A.
I am.
They're my boys. Shout out to Joby for sorting this out as well.
He's
Joby been like
the
middleman for the last 10 days. Joby's, every couple of hours.
He's the man.
Like, hey, Joby, we're going to make it happen. We're going to make it. He's the best. Dude, the reason I like doing these is because you just get to know people in a bit more of like a... It's like speed dating.
Sure.
The way I look at it often is like, you know, you can do a 10-date tour with someone and you'll exchange short little like pleasantries.
Yeah.
But then when you sit down for an hour and you go, well, boom, then it's like, right, okay.
Just jump in it.
Right? I hope you enjoyed it too, man.
I did,
thank
brother.
You so
thank
much.
You very much.
Big up. We'll do part two again, right?
Absolutely.